Now we move over to the main business of the afternoon for us all, and I'm delighted to welcome our speaker Dag Haug from the University of Oslo. He's been employed in various roles there since I think 1999, but is now Professor of Greek and Latin. Doug started out as a specialist in Homeric philology and comparative Indo-European linguistics, but as you know, he now has a much wider range of interests, ranging from historical linguistics, syntax within an LFG framework, and formal semantics, published widely on anaphora, for example. Some of his work, again, as I'm sure you'll know, has a strong computational slant, and he led the PROIL project, if that's how you pronounce the acronym. The acronym's always difficult to do, but it's Pragmatic Resources in Old Indo-European Languages, which was funded by the Research Council of Norway for outstanding researchers. And so that tells you something about the prestige and the standing of that project. And as part of that project, Dag and his team produced a tree bank containing not just the original Greek text, the New Testament and translations into a range of early Indo-European languages, the Communion, Latin, Roman Church, the one, but it's grown and extended to include a number of other Greek and Latin texts, and now that site also hosts, again, I'm sure you know this, data from other languages, including the Enderin, actually many old Lance texts as well. Today he's going to present his work to us, finite listening in Greek and Latin, then and now.
Okay, thank you very much for that kind introduction. Sorry. Does that work? Yeah, it works this way, right? Yeah, okay.
Whoops.
Everything's fine, yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. And thank you very much for the kind invitation to come here and speak to the society. So I'll be speaking about finiteness then in Greek and Latin. So just first, very briefly, the concept, as you know, right? It's something that is usually defined by features that finite forms have, right, and or may not have, but which non-finite forms always lack, right? So things like person, number, and mood, and tense in the morphological domain, right? And then in the syntactic domain, overt subjects, especially non-oblique subjects, right? Overt nominative subjects. And independent clauses, so the ability to be an independent root clause. And in terms of semantics, they have finite sentences can be said to have illocutionary force. They express a proposition, for example. But, I mean, the reason why it's interesting is because these features tend to correlate, right? And we're going to see a little bit about that, how they thought about that in antiquity, before we go on to see the Greek and Latin data. So that's one obvious reason why it's interesting. But it's also interesting for me because it's an important heritage of classical grammar in modern linguistics, right? So it's a concept that comes from ancient grammar and that is still relevant in modern linguistics. And it's a field where Greek and Latin data have the potential to contribute to general linguistic theory. So those are reasons for giving this talk, I guess. So the plan will be like this. So first I'll say something about how ancient grammarians, in particular Apollonius, thought about finiteness. And then I'm going to show you a number of data from Greek and Latin that shows that finiteness isn't such an easy concept, even in Greek and Latin, right? So the sort of concept from Greek and Latin grammar is does not apply to Greek and Latin, as it were, or at least there are challenging data, right? Okay, so first, this, the history of the idea. So we need to remember then that non-finite verb in ancient grammar generally means infinitive, right? Because the participle is a separate part of speech, right? So it's not even a verb. Because it has case and gender and so on, it's sort of intermediate between nouns and verbs, and it's a separate part of speech. Which means that there's no unified notion of what we would call non-finiteness, right? A non-finite verb. It's basically about separating the infinitive from the other forms. And so there's some discussion in literature on what sets infinitives apart from the finite forms, and also whether infinitives are verbs at all, right? So you could get away, so you could end up with saying that finiteness is a property of verbs, right? Because everything that isn't finite is not a verb. But that's not what Avalonius argues for, and that's not what we're going to see here. So basically, infinitives are verbs, but they're crucially non-finite, and that's the because they lack certain features. So as I said, we're looking at Apollonius and his book on syntax, which is one of the most important sources and most influential sources. The infinitive is aparemphatos, right? So it's more or less without secondary meaning, right? So para and final, right? So it means something aside, and it's a, right? Privative, a. So it does not have these secondary meanings, right? Which means that it only has the essentials of what it takes to be a verb, while a finite verb will have that, and then a number of other features, other associated meanings or secondary meanings or para, meanings. Those secondary meanings of finite verbs, on his view, are number and person and disposition of the mind, which is probably the most interesting one, psychike diathesis. So those are the things that will set finite verbs apart from the infinitive. Right. So he argues for this, right? Number and person is not too difficult. So he says that they can't be, I mean, they're not properties of the act itself, right? So the act is only one, so the event that the verb refers to is only one, no matter whether it's a plural subject, right? And the verb is plural, so that means there are plural participants or whatever, but there's still only one act going on, right? So number is quite clearly not a property of the verb, right? So it's not essential for what it takes to be a verb. But disposition of the mind is the more interesting one. So here's what he says in an interesting passage. So if someone declares peripatai trufon, right? So trufon is walking. One could transform that into indirect speech by adding the meaning of the indicative mood. I mean, horisato, so he X indicated, someone said, or someone indicated. So horisato is formed from the verb that gives horistike, which is the indicative mood, right? That's the idea. So X indicated. And then one would say horisato peripatain trufona, where you get an infinitive. So basically what he's doing here is decomposing, as it were, the meaning of the indicative, right? You have the, actually, is there a pointer? Would probably be helpful, but maybe there isn't. Okay. Peripatai there on the top is the indicative. Yeah, I could try and point with the mouse if it's, yeah, right, yeah, here, right? This indicative. And he says you can, now you can, decompose this, right? So you get someone said or indicated that Trufon walked, right? And here you get an infinitive structure. And you can do similar with the optative, right? So another finite form, peripatoia Trufon, right? So would that Trufon walked or whatever. And then you add the meaning of a wish, right? So that would be exato peripatein Trufona, ex wished that, right? And in the imperative, peripateito trufon, right? So you could, someone ordered that, right? Prosetaxa. So it's decomposing the moods that have finite forms into some verb which expresses, he says, the disposition of the mind of the speaker towards the proposition, one could say, in modern parlance. And then the infinitive with the subject, which expresses that, which is that proposition, right? The original proposition. So, and that's the disposition of the mind. So, so they can be things like indicate, wish, order, but it's much more general also, because he does generalize this concept to the subjunctive, right? Where it's much harder, right? Because if you look at the grammar of Greek, the subjunctive can do a lot of stuff, right? So what he says is, and here the name again works well, right? Because the subjunctive is the hypotaktike, right? It's the mood of subordination. And the idea is that the subjunctive expresses a disposition of the mind that comes from the subjunction that is used, right? So aeon, if, gives you a conditional reading or doubt, as he calls it. And that's another disposition of the mind. So that is crucial to his argument, then, that you have more it's something like mood, but you have more dispositions on the mind than you have moods, right? And this is what gives us finite forms, right? Something like propositional attitude. And crucially, for our purposes, he connects the two dimensions, right? So the morphology and the semantics, right? He says disposition of the mind is not crucial to verbs. It's something that makes a verb finite, something that non-finite verbs do not have, but it's not something you need to have. That argument again relies on the event, as it were, right? Because it's not part of the event, just like the number is not part of the event, the disposition of the mind towards the express proposition is not part of the event. Forms lacking this are still verbs that are crucially non-finite. But there's no comparable paraphrase, right? Obviously, because this paraphrase uses the infinitive, so you couldn't possibly paraphrase the infinitive using the infinitive. Right, now he connects the two. So the disposition of the mind, he connects it with number and person. The argument here, to as far as I can see, but maybe I'm misconstruing him, does look a bit faulty. So because it seems that he's relying on the fact that here, you know, when you add these dispositions of the mind, as it were, that's where you get the endings, right? That's where you get the indication of a person and number. If that really is the argument, as was argued in the 19th century, then he's really mixing up, participants in the original act and the speech art participants, right? So there are articles that try to save his argument in other ways and so on, but I'm not going into the details here anyway, because the important thing for us today, I think, is that he does see a connection, right? That's what makes the concept interesting, right? So you have this disposition of the mind, and it's connected to morphological features, namely person and number. Yeah. So it's worth pointing out that tense is not a finiteness property. And again, the argument here relies on, you know, properties of the event, because the event as expressed is, of course, located in time. So tense would be a property of the event itself. So it can't really be a finiteness feature for him. That's very different from most modern conceptions of finiteness, but still, that's what he says. And he argues then, because of that, that the distinction that we would know, called a spectral, between infinitives, so those are two Greek infinitives, right? The perfective and imperfective infinitive, or present and aorist infinitive. And he argues that the distinction is temporal. So non-finite forms will also have time, or tense, sorry. And he also says that tense is not even so, is not a finiteness property, and is also not a sufficient property to be a verb at all, right? Because participles do have tense, he says, even though they're not verbs, right? They're a separate class part of speech, but they do have tense. And in particular, he argues that what we now call the present participle or the imperfective participle is actually a participle of both present tense and past tense, so it's syncretic. And he gives examples where you sort of transform a verb into the participle, and whether it's a present tense or an imperfective in the past, in the original indicative, it turns into the same participle. So that's worth mentioning. Also worth pointing out, in terms of features that we now think of as finiteness features, possibly, is that of being able to take a subject. And he actually argues against infinitives taking subjects. Not only nominative subjects here, right? He seems to want the accusative in accusative with infinitive structures always to go with the governing verb. So here's the first, probably simplest example from him. Dei eme akouein, I must write the letter. Sorry, where did I get it? Oh, I mixed up two examples here. Yeah, I have to listen, sorry, yeah. That would be weird, right? That's non-compositional semantics. Really, truly non-compositional semantics. Yeah, sorry about that. Anyway, he argues that the accusative goes with they, right? So it's an object. It's not the subject of the infinitive. And he generalizes this to other examples. So here we have an indicative, so peri eche ho uranos tangens, so the heaven surrounds the earth, and if you transform this into indirect speech, in doing this transposition, he moves the uranon, right, so that it's comes before the infinitive and closer to the governing verb, and he says it's the object of, right, so he wants to analyze every ACI as not having really a subject. So subject being able to host the subject is a property of finite verbs, the way he sees it. It's not entirely clear how you can actually make that argument work, but yeah, he leaves it there. So if we sum up what we see there, we find the idea that certain inflections are crucial to finiteness, as in modern theory as well, personal number, and also sometimes he mentions voice, although there's not that much discussion of it. And then the presence of these inflections is tied to the semantic notion of disposition of the mind. So that's, in that sense, a similar concept to what we have today. Certain morphological things that go together with certain semantic things here, and also some syntactic things like the ability to host the subject. So I'm going to leave it there, but I just wanted to point out how I think maybe this actually got into later Greek and Latin grammar and the traditions. So, and I think it's in the tradition of philosophical grammar, and the works in particular actually of James Harris, which is cited a lot, and many of you don't know this, but in Wolff's early works on classical philology, you know, he founded classical philology as a discipline, right? And his books and his encyclopedia of antiquity and so on, the works that founded the discipline, are really full of references to James Harris's work, and he recommends a lot, so everyone who wants to do Greek and Latin should read a lot of James Harris. And here you do find a very similar idea, probably through Priscian, who is quoted here, right? So take away the assertion, the command, or whatever else gives the character to one of these modes, again, and there remains nothing more than a mere infinitive, right? So basically, finite form consists of an infinitive and then some sort of modal meaning. And this, I think, is how it made it into Hermann's grammar of Greek and really into, so finiteness is a concept in modern era grammars of Greek and Latin. Okay, so much about the history. Now, if we look at modern linguistics, we see similar things, right? So there are a number of features. Crucially, now tense is usually listed as a finiteness feature. In semantics, there's this assertion idea, right? That a finite, at least an indicative, will be an assertion. And then in syntax, you can have an overt subject, often qualified as an agreeing or a nominative subject. Right, depending on how you think about absolute diffs and ACIs. Okay, and then people notice that there are a certain number of problems with this, right? So these things don't always go as neatly together as you would expect, right? So you get non-finite-like forms with personal number morphology, like these inflected infinitives in Romance, and modern Greek subjunctives that are really infinitive-like, right? In having controlled subjects and so on. And you get finite-like forms without personal number, obviously. And yeah, so people saw that, well, these things don't go together as neatly as they're supposed to do in the traditional picture. And then this leads to what I call here the Greek and Latin straitjacket topos in modern linguistics, something you often see, right? So here's Wolfgang Klein saying that this strategy, namely looking for translation equivalents in Latin, has guided a great deal of our description of languages other than those for which traditional grammatical categories were originally proposed. That is for Greek and Latin. So that's Klein, and then similar, like many other traditional notions, finiteness and its related concepts have been borrowed from the Greek or Latin tradition for the purpose of describing certain grammatical phenomena in other languages, and they don't fit, right? That's the idea. So these traditional notions, this has resulted in various inconsistencies in the application of the finiteness label, right? So supposedly it's, you know, we inherited a concept that only works for Greek and Latin, and then we apply it to other languages, and we see it doesn't work. Right, so the implication is that We have a fixed concept of finiteness from the Greek or Latin tradition, but it's cross-linguistically inadequate, so now we need to go look at other languages to improve our concept and learn more. But I'll argue that's not true, right? So it is true that the traditional notion of finiteness does come from Greek and Latin grammarians, but there's still a lot more that we can learn about finiteness only by looking at the Greek and Latin data already. So I'll present three case studies. So that's finite like meaning in participles, finite like syntax in participles, and then a little bit about finite like syntax and semantics in infinitives. I'm using here participles from Greek and infinitives from Latin just to represent both languages, but we could do vice versa actually. Okay, so first about participles. Well, here's just the system, so you can have a look. So there are plenty of participles, right? So you have a four-way quasi-aspectual distinction, and then you have the active and the medial passive, and then you have passive participles for some tenses as well, right? So lots of them. You have lots of usages, right? So here I'm just illustrating with English. You can have them as attributes, as heads, as complements, and in absolutes. But crucially, the ones we'll be looking at are the free adjuncts, or conjunct participles, as they're called, right? Where you give some sort of, well, in this example, right, he arrived running, it says something about how he arrived, right? But a lot of other things can happen. You should know, as we'll see, then that there's always agreement in case number and gender between the participle and its subject in all these usages. Okay, so if we look at the conjunct participles, so the ones where they're adjunct-like, they give you some more information about the event, or however you want to describe it, you'll typically find in grammars the idea that the participle gives you some secondary meaning, some secondary aspect of the event, and it can relate to the main verb via a lot of different adverbial relations. So manner, means, cause, purpose, condition, etc., etc., etc. And that's true, there's a bit more to it than that, I think. So, because if we think of it in terms of discourse cohesion and in terms of events being described, there's a big difference between the first two and the other, so manner and means, right? So participles that give you manner and means are actually participles that elaborate on the main event, and they're really dependent on the main event. They give you some secondary aspect. Like he arrived without running, the running and the arrival are parts of the same event, as it were. And that's not true for the second ones. And that's why the second ones you'll get very interesting readings where it really seems to approach a main cause. Examples where you have two distinct events. And this point is important. So I think there's an ambiguity here, right? So it's not like what you find in traditional grammars that you just have this scale of meanings that are available, but it's really about, there is a structural distinction between the ones that give you one event and the ones that give you two events. That will be important later. That doesn't mean it's easier to resolve just because it's ambiguous, but it can still be hard to know in context which is the right one. Anyway, here's just a typical example of the ones that are not interesting for us, the elaboration ones, which are really dependent on the verb they belong to. So, grammata graphosi Hellenes men apoton aristeron apitera dexia ferontes tenchera. Right. So the Greeks write letters and calculate with stones. I left that out of the original example. It's actually in the Greek. But it's not in the example I've cited here, by moving the hand from left to right, right? So the writing of the letter is the same, I mean, and the moving, they're the same, you know, describing the same event, right? here we really have a non-finite form in the sense you could not, if we use Apollonius' test, you could really not easily apply this periphrasis without taking into account the event that it's dependent on, right? So the writing. Because the point is not, he said that they moved their hand from left to right. It's that they move their hands, when they're writing, they move their hands from left to right. So it's really dependent on the finite verb. Then you get the others. We have two events. Often it will be the case that the event expressed by the participle is rather predictable, and I have argued even a presupposition, anaphoric. So yeah, and they serve to give you some discourse cohesion. So here's again from Herodotus. So the Memnadae got the sovereignty, taking it from the Heraclidae. And the Memnadae is Gyges belongs to them, right? And so you can say when he had become king, because it's basically just referring back to what was just said, right? It's just providing some cohesion and locating the event of Gyges sending offerings to Delphi. So again, that's really a participle which does not express, and it does not assert the existence of an event. It refers back to some event that is implicit in the context. But that's not always the case. And now we come to the interesting examples where the really main clause like. And in these cases, the participle does take on the modal force of the finite verb. So it inherits the modality of the finite verb it attaches to, but it expresses its own event, which is coordinated, as it were, with the finite verb. So things like this. Here we have an imperative. Take the child, right? Paralabe topaideon is the finite, so the imperative with its object. And then you have a participle dependent on that. And this does not mean when you wake up, take the child, right? It really means wake up and take the child, right? So it works here like two coordinated verbs, as it were, both in the imperative mood, as it were. Although the first one is a participle. So here it's independent. And if it's in the indicative, it does assert the existence of a separate event. And that's what's happening in the next verse here in the Bible. So, and he woke up and took the child with him, right? So now we have the indicative mood, aorist, with a participle that now expresses, because the mood of the finite verb is indicative, it does assert the existence of an event. So in that sense, it's finite and could be paraphrased with something like X indicated that Joseph woke up. So here we really get finite semantics for the participle. And as I said, I think this is a structural ambiguity. We don't need to care about the details, actually. So, but what is interesting is this, that they also interact with the context, not via the finite verb that they depend on. So they're not, so as I'll say in the conclusion, I think this supports some sort of gradient notion of finiteness where they're not completely finite. They can't stand on their own, right? They do need a finite verb in the standard varieties. But they can still interact with the context, as it does here, right? So he, Cyrus, decided and acted immediately. He drove his army to Lydia, right? And that's the important thing he does. And went himself as a messenger to Croesus. That's actually not very important in the context here. So what he decides and needs to do very quickly is to get his army to Lydia. And this is expressed with a participle. So the discourse cohesion in terms of discourse relations, if you think of some your favorite theory of discourse structure, this participle thing here does attach to this, right? It explains what he did in haste. So the aorist here does not simply say, as you'll find in traditional grammars of Greek, that the event expressed by the participle precedes the event expressed by the finite verb. It's more subtle than that, and it's really important that this goes with the previous discourse. So in that sense, it's independent, an independent discourse unit, as it were. and not at all backgrounded, as you'll often find. So in that sense, it's semantically, it has finite-like properties of being an assertion, right, if we think in Wolfgang Klein's terms. But then they don't have, obviously, the morphological features of finiteness, right? So there's no personal number. There is number, but it agrees, because it agrees with the subject. And there's no tense. But they do have this own, their own illocutionary forms, they force, and they can be paraphrased in this Apollonius-like way, ex ordered that he should wake up and that he should take his child. So it's a separate order, as it were. Okay, so that's the semantics and how participles can actually be independent assertions of events. Next thing, subjects. Because, as I mentioned, subjects, and in particular nominative subjects, are really hallmarks of finiteness. It's something that people tend to think should really only work with finite verbs. But we'll see that Greek participles, in fact, can have nominative subjects, structurally at least. And also, those are actually exactly the ones we looked at. We need to say a bit about Greek word order to identify these. So it's very free, people know. But it's not so free that we can't normally identify participle clauses. So in a sense, I think the moral of what I will be saying is that word order is really free inside clauses, but not across clauses. There are lots of constraints on what you can do across clauses. So here's one nicely behaving participle clause. So these lent aid in return for a similar service. So the participle clause is what is rendered as in return for a similar service in the translation, and it's a separate word order unit inside the finite clause, as it were, which starts with hutoi. And then, having said that, cursus sent for adrestus. So again, a nice continuous participle clause. But then we see these, which are the interesting ones. Cursus was amazed at what had been said. So amazed is the verb here, right? Here, that's the participle. And then what had been said is here, and crucially, the nominative subject goes between the participle and its object. Right? And then comes the rest of the main clause. So in principle, you now say that, well, this croesus thing is still the matrix subject, and what has happened here is that somehow the participle clause is broken up. Right? That's a possibility, but the other possibility is that croesus really is the subject of the participle, and we have what is called backward control. So I'm illustrating this with Greek, but I just wanted to point out this is not at all in common in Latin either, right? So Caesar can do this. So as I said, one possibility is that these are just discontinuous clauses, right? And if so, it would have to be some sort of discontinuity, which means in most theories that it will have to be either some sort of relativization or topicalization going on, or extraposition, or what is called scrambling. You just mix the words, right? And it would have to be the third type, right? That's the only way you could get things like this. And things like, well, here you could argue that a participle has been topicalized, but there are other examples where it doesn't work out so nicely. So there would be two possible analyses. Here again, a biblical example, just to show you that this goes in different genres of Greek. So waking up, yeah, let's just look at the example first. Waking up Joseph from the dream, right? So there's a prepositional phrase that goes with the participle and the subject. Nominative subject is between the participle and this PP. And then he did something, right? In principle, you could get something like on the left-hand side where you have some sort of scrambling going on and the participle clause is broken up. Or you could have the right-hand side structure, which gives you an NP inside the participle clause. So the nominative subject really is in the participle, right? It's governed by the participle. And that's the one I've argued for in a recent article. so the one on the right, where the participle actually has a nominative subject. And the data is so, and in arguing for that, we used the tree banks that we've been developing. So looking at what kinds of discontinuities are really possible with participle clauses. And it turns out that you can, the only thing that can ever break up a participle clause is the subject of that participle clause, right? So if this was the sort of scrambling analysis here was right, you would predict that anything could go here, right? But it turns out it can't, right? It has to be the subject of the participle. And we get good numbers on this. So the so out of in New Testament, out of 1,308 participle clauses, not a single one is discontinuous if you allow subjects to be counted inside the participle clause. Whereas there are 50 that are discontinuous in that case. Up here, right? So that is the data. I mean, there are much more to this argument to be said, right? And there's statistical analysis and so on. I'm not presenting you with all this, but the point, the moral of the story is the participle actually does have a subject position. And it's the same kind of participle, right? The ones that express a separate event. He woke up and did this and that. So if we sum up the participles, they do have finite-like semantics in the sense that they do express an assertion, do assert the existence of some event, and they can do this sort of discourse connection thing, and they can have subjects. And as I said a number of times, and that's the interesting thing, right? It does go together. So the ones that have finite-like semantics are the ones that can have a subject. The ones that elaborate on another event or dependent on the other event can never have a subject, right? As far as we can tell, obviously, but the data, these constructions are actually quite frequent. So that's interesting that the properties do go together in the way that has been predicted since Apollonius, at least. Okay, so and then the next study is about infinitives. So this is more tentative ongoing work. So we saw these participles with finite-like syntax and semantics. They can never be independent root clauses in the sense that you can stop the sentence there, right? So the participle is, even though it does express its own event, assert the existence of its own event, it's syntactically, in a sense, dependent on the finite verb. There needs to be a finite verb in the clause, in the sentence, sorry, in standard varieties. But it's actually interesting to see, if you look at later Greek and Latin texts, that you very often this does not happen. So I don't know whether that's because they don't know how to use participles, so whether it's something else. I mean, that's an interesting thing that people should really look at, but yeah. But with infinitives, and in particular accusative with infinitive structures, ACIs, they can be independent root clauses. So they can, I'll argue, you know, be syntactic objects, root clauses in their own right. But first, just to show you, you probably would agree with this anyway, but just to show you, I mean, infinitives are morphologically non-finite, right, in Latin. I mean, that's not really surprising. They don't express deictic tense. They only express tense relative to the matrix verb, right? So bonum esse fuisse futurum. So I say that Mark is, has been, will be good. I said that Mark was, had been, would be good. And the infinitives remain the same, right? There's no aspect in infinitive, so do you have reduced morphology? So whether you report Mark was eating or Mark ate is going to end up in the same way in the ACI. There's no mood, so whether you report a hypothetical conditional or an indicative conditional, it's going to end up the same way if you report it. So lots of non-finiteness in the morphological sense then, right? Lacking a lot of these things. But you knew that. Anyway, so what we're looking at now will be ACIs, accusative with infinitive structures, the ones that Apollonius analyzed for ancient Greek. Here's very straightforward. It's the nicest example to use to illustrate the construction because it's so, I mean, when you look, you have to use natural examples from corpora, it's rare to find such a nice short example with only necessary, well, suppose we could delete the subject, matrix subject. anyway, almost only necessary words. So it is accusative with infinitive is a structure where you have an infinitive and an accusative subject, and then possibly an object as here. And it's the standard complementation structure in Latin, right? So this is very straightforward in direct speech. I confess that I love her. The interesting thing is that these can be used unembedded, in unembedded contexts. So here's an example from Cicero. Redi captivos negavit esse utile, so he denied that it would be expedient to return the prisoners. And then it goes on in the accusative with infinitive. Illos enim adolescentes esse, so for they were young men, et bonus duces and good officers, se iam confectum senectuta, while he was already consumed with age. So 1, 2, and 3 are all ACIs, accusative with infinitives. They cannot be coordinated, right? If you assume there's some null coordination going on here, you get the wrong reading, because the first one is denied, right? The matrix verb is negavit, while the second two are asserted, right? So coordination gives wrong results. That's not what's going on. So then the temptation would be to postulate some sort of implicit speech verb, right? So these are really syntactically embedded, because an ACI can't be a root clause, right? So there's some sort of implicit but syntactically present verb of saying, right? That's what I'm going to argue against. First, I just wanted to say that is, I mean, Apollonius actually did, to save some parts of his theory, he actually did use null verbs, implicit verbs of saying, right? For a slightly different construction, the epistolary construction, he says, oh, there's some implicit verb. There has to be, because an infinitive can't be, can't close the sentence, katakleia logon, right? It can't be a complete sentence. But I don't think there is in these ACIs. And there are at least two reasons why an implicit verb gives you the wrong predictions for these ACI structures. We get the discourse cohesions wrong. I'll look at the scope of discourse particles for that. And we get the syntax of rhetorical questions wrong. So for the first argument on discourse cohesion, I'm going to look at the scope of the discourse particle enim, but we could repeat this with others. And also actually general principles of discourse cohesion, even when there's no overt particle. Anyway, here's an example of enim in a context where we have an overt verb of saying, right? So per jocundus mihi Cincius venit ante diem blablabla ante lucem. So Cincius was a very welcome arrival. For he tells me, dixit enim mihi te esse in Italia, right? So for he tells me that you are in Italy. The point here is that it's the saying that gives the cause for the right? It's the fact that he reports that you are in Italy that gives, is the reason for the previous clause, right? Enim is a causal connector, but what it connects here is the fact that there was some report, and that's the reason for a particular thing being very welcome, right? So the saying is the cause for rejoice, as it were. Enim, or put in other terms, in terms of logical form or something, enim, the causal connector, scopes over dixit, right? Dixit is part of what is the cause. More generally, it scopes over all the material in its sentence, right? It goes in second position in its sentence for reasons that are irrelevant here, but it does scope over the whole sentence. And if we contrast that with what happens when you have dixit in a context with no overt verb of saying, we see that the scope is different. So here, again from Cicero, dixit hanc legem publium clodium iam ante servasse. So there's this law being discussed in the Senate. And Cicero says that Publius Clodius already followed that law, which has not yet been agreed on, for he used to be in the habit of promising, promitiare et non dare, of promising money and not giving them. Here, this enim works, as it were, inside the report, right? It's not the saying, it's not Cicero's saying of that Publius Clodius had been in the habit of doing this and that, that is the cause for the previous sentence, right? It's the enim works sort of inside the report, right? this means that if you suppose there's a null verb here in the syntactic structure, you'd have to say that that null verb has different scope properties from overt verbs of saying, right? Because enim always, when enim is in a sentence with an overt verb of saying, it always scopes over that verb, right? You'd have to say there's a null verb, but that has different scope properties. It actually, enim scopes under null verbs, but over overt verbs, as it were, which makes it, less, I mean, very unattractive, really, as a hypothesis, right? So we're operating not only with null elements, but null elements that have different properties that we can't actually observe with real elements. So I'll just show you two examples, but you can get tons of examples like this, actually. And it's always how it works. Enim does scope over the whole thing, and enim inside an embedded ACI, as I'll get out, gives you discourse internal, I mean, a reason that is internal to the reported discourse. So that's the first argument. The second argument comes from questions. So questions in indirect speech, the rule is that they go in the subjunctive, right? So here's a prime example. He explains what his plan is. The verb of the embedded question is in the subjunctive. Same goes for these long pages. So I didn't mention this, but most of you may know, right, that these unembedded ACIs can go on for pages, right, in particular in CISO, right? You can have several pages of everything is in the ACI. And if a question turns up in such a structure, it goes in the subjunctive, normally. So that's what you get here, right? So and he said, what did he want, etc. But if we look at rhetorical questions, it's different. If a rhetorical question is embedded under an overt verb of saying or of asking, you get a subjunctive. So that's here. This is Sophocles. So his sons try to get control of his property because he's imbecile, and then he points to his latest work, and then he's said to have read his poem to the judges and to have asked whether that poem seemed like the work of an imbecile. So this is a rhetorical question, obviously, and it's embedded under an overt verb of asking, quaesisse here, and it goes into subjunctive because it's overtly embedded. However, if you now go back to these long passages of ACIs that you get in CSR, etc., rhetorical questions go in the ACI and not in the subjunctive, right? So unembedded rhetorical questions actually are different, right? They're ACIs. Here's an example. So you can see, what could be more undetermined and more undignified, right? Quid esse levius, etc., etc. That's how it goes on, right? So it's in the ACI. So again, we have a difference between these ACIs and overtly embedded stuff, right? And we need to have some explanation for that syntactic difference, and the obvious explanation is to take lack of embedding. So here there's no embedding verb, and to just take that at face value and say that these ACIs really are independent root clauses. The syntactic sentence is just this, what we see here, and it's different. It's in the infinitive. It's not a finite verb. Also interesting is that this actually points to a semantic rationale for these unembedded ACIs, right? Because it's not the form that decides, right? If a question is rhetorical, right, so it expresses an assertion, and that's what gives you the ACI, right? So there's a semantic reason why you get an ACI. Not that I know why it should be an ACI, but I mean, it's not decided on form alone, right? It's not the case that all questions go into subjunctive. It depends on the semantics. However, they do come with the presupposition that it's someone else's assertion, right? Or in the case of a question, someone else's question, right? So that's clearly a part of the meaning, and we need to get that in somehow, probably as a presupposition. This is actually quite similar to the German konjunktiv eins, the thing that can also go on in the subjunctive for pages in German subjunctives. And there are some analysis of that German subjunctive that could probably be made to work for Latin as well. It's a very interesting construction, I think, just as an aside here, because it allows you to report a discourse, right? So it's reported speech, goes in third person, etc., etc. But you can actually report the structure of the discourse as well, unlike what we can in, I mean, we can't do that in Norwegian, and I think not really in English either, right? You, in translations, they tend to insert parenthetical "he said" or something, or sometimes if they're very literal, they just translate with "that" clauses all the way, right? And then you "that" clause. So it's a very interesting construction. But for our purposes, it's interesting because they have infinitives, non-finite verbs, that are root clauses. So to sum up, I think we can say that Greek and Latin actually themselves don't fit the Greek and Latin straitjacket, right? That's the main takeaway, I guess. And this means that the picture in the tradition from Apollonius is too simplified, which is probably not surprising, right? This is the birth of grammar, as it were, and they didn't get everything right at the first try. There isn't a simple connection here between the lack of these morphological features that we looked at and the syntax semantics, but there is a connection. There is some connection, at least between the syntax and the semantics, right, in these finite-like uses. So we saw that exactly the participles with the subject positions are exactly the ones that can have this independent assertoric force. And the unembedded infinitive is the ACI, not control infinitives. You don't have something like unembedded control infinitives, whatever that should be, right? Both of them actually allow discourse connections outside the sentence boundary. So that's what we saw with this endem. It gives you the causal connection in the reported discourse. And this points to somehow a graded in the sense that there are boundaries on the finiteness because these infinitives, for example, do give you discourse connections, but crucially inside the reported discourse, right? So they're not completely free, less free than finite forms in interacting with the surrounding discourse, for example. Also, it's some sort of construction of finiteness, so it's tied to specific phrase structural patterns like the ACI, and as I skipped, but also for the participles, these are, I mean, it's not lexical, right? It's not the participle and the infinitive that has this property. It's the participle in a certain configuration and the infinitive in a certain configuration. So in that sense, the finiteness belongs to a larger piece of structure. And then methodology. There's still a lot to learn about Greek and Latin syntax, and I think it's particularly interesting that these constructions that we looked at are not very rare or anything, right? It's things that you really encounter when you read Greek and Latin texts. We just need to look closer at them and using general linguistic theory and so on to think more deeply about what they really do. But the data are actually, to a large extent, in the grammars already, descriptively at least. So, thank you.
Thank you very much for this talk, which I'd say was in the very best of the Philological Society traditions using linguistic theory to inform data to inform linguistic theories.
Thank you.
An interesting talk. I know there's a lot of specialists in the audience who will ask the questions for you.
At the start, you seem to be leaving aspect out of your account. You did suggest it was a finiteness feature, and I couldn't think it was either. But then it seemed to sneak in when you began talking about Latin.
Oh, right, yeah.
More about that.
Yeah, no, so, well, that was just, yeah, maybe I should have. Yeah, so you mean here, right? Yeah. So here, that's true. I just wanted to show that, because sometimes people just say, well, non-finite forms are morphologically reduced, and they're not so specific about the features, right? So they have less distinctions, and that's what I want to show here. But I don't think aspect is a finiteness feature. It's pretty clear that you can have aspectual distinctions in some languages, like Greek, and in participles, obviously. Yeah, so that was not my intention. Yeah, but I see your point, yeah. Thanks.
To ask about those accusative infinitive.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I've always thought that they were the equivalent of free and direct style in Latin equivalent. And I'm just thinking about it in terms of what you're talking
right.
about.
Yeah.
Because I'm interested, you say that tense occupies a different status. And of course, in English, the basic way of constructing those kind of sentences is to mix a past tense with a present temporal. So, was now, for instance.
Yeah.
And that will give you almost an immediate impression of the same kind of thing, of a discourse filtered through somebody's speech or thought.
Yeah.
In the same way.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you've thought about the relation of the Latin construction to other ways of realizing this. And you have special
right.
quotative modalities in some languages. Don't
yeah.
You?
Yeah.
Bulgarian, I think.
Mm. Yeah. So I think this is different from free and direct discourse. Because in free and direct discourse, you change the person and perhaps the tense, but everything else looks like it's direct, right? It's free and direct discourse is generally, I think, closer to quotation. And I think in this, so for example, you can get exclamatives, I guess, right, in free and direct discourse, hooray or something. He was going to blah, 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 which I've had a hard time finding in these unembedded ACIs. I looked for it, but that's mm-hmm. not to say they don't exist.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's interesting to see if it is the same phenomenon. Mm. But what I can't come up with a good example now, but I can definitely did find examples of noun phrases in ACIs like this that have to be interpreted relative to the external speaker, so dere as it were, which I don't think you can get in free and direct speech. That's a clear distinction, but I don't have any good examples on my slide. But it does something similar, obviously. Yeah, Philemon.
Just a follow-up comment. There's an odd thing that happens sometimes in Greek reporting of oaths, which is that amen, which seems to be an exclamative that you can use when you're swearing, gets carried over into the reported oath.
Right.
So he swore amen.
Right. So in oaths. Right.
Or something like that.
Right. Okay, that's interesting. Yeah,
but
that's.
On the other hand, suppose there you've actually got the verb. I don't know whether you ever get it.
Right.
The
Thank you very much. I was wondering if you see, because for the unembedded ACIs, you only give the examples in Latin. I was
mm-hmm.
wondering if you see the same kind of problem with Greek.
Yeah,
as
you do.
Well,
yeah, you do.
For like syntax or the cohesion problems. And I know in like Herodotus, this kind of thing happens a lot, and sometimes there's not even a verb reported in the scene at all. So.
Right, yeah. And you don't need, neither in Greek or in Latin, you need even the initial speech verb, right? You do need some, I think, that's my impression, you need something that makes it likely that there was a saying going on, right? A very typical case in Latin is that you have mit, right? So you send some messengers. And then you turn into ACI, right? That's really common. Often, of course, you get something like he asked whether blah, blah blah, and then you go into the ACI. Though obviously he didn't ask those things. Then you switch into saying, right? And things like that. And I think it's my impression, although I didn't do careful studies of this, that Greek and Latin work pretty similarly. Yeah.
Would you say
that? And that it's always, I think. Almost only saying, I don't know if you could do thoughts, so that's another difference from free indirect speech, maybe, right? And thinking, maybe you can.
In Herodotus, there's a passage about he dreamed.
He dreamed, right, yeah, so there is, that's true, yeah, that is true, yes, exactly, so that's good, yes. Right, yeah, interesting.
Another question about, I was wondering how do you understand, like, genitive absolutes for, like, is it like as finite as, say, like how you want.
Right, so whether you can do, I mean, sometimes you do actually get that impression, but I mean, most ACIs will fall into what I call the framing category, so somehow they link to the previous discourse. There's something implicit about in the discourse. But sometimes you really get the impression that you would need to translate it with a finite verb, I think. Yeah. So you can get similar effects. Which is interesting.
Thank you very much. Can I get back to the beginning of your talk,
right,
that
yeah.
setting out the development, if you like, that these are categories which wouldn't be that and then were used more widely.
Yeah.
But then people found that actually there is a sort of mismatch. Now this was beautifully demonstrated that mismatch actually also exists in Greek Latin. But then that leaves, you know, me with the question, I think it's a discourse which a number of people have at the moment. What the value of these categories is to start with. So is that cross-linguistic category of finiteness and is it useful? Or you know, is what we do as a typologist, do what you've done, and actually have, you know, much more fine-grained discussion of specific languages. But then what does that mean for the comparability of languages across different families?
Yeah. Now that's very interesting and a huge question, right? So what I think is interesting in the Greek and Latin data is that even though the original concept doesn't work that well, there are still some connections between what is the syntactic and the semantic side of finiteness, as it were, and that could be an interesting starting point, I guess, for typological studies. Where do you find the same connections? Even if things aren't as straightforward as they're supposed to be, right? You can still find these connections. But that wouldn't necessarily help you give something like, cross-linguistically valid definition of typology, which I'm certainly not going to attempt. So, yeah. Well.
You had a remark about how later Latin authors sometimes do different things. Do those kind of examples support your general hypothesis about the graded nature of finiteness, or do they challenge it in other ways?
No, so, yeah. First of all, I should say that when I say gradient here, it doesn't necessarily mean that there's a scale, right? That
mm-hmm.
just that there are other,
yeah.
you know, intermediate values, possible intermediate values, right? So, yeah. As for the historical data, I don't know, but it's really interesting to see in Vulgar Latin texts, for example, how often you get this backward control pattern where the nominative subject is inside the participle clause, and then quite frequently they just stop and nothing comes out of the participle. Yeah, but I don't know if there is a special study of that and what tells you. I mean, you get into all these problems whether they're just simulating nice classical syntax or whether they're actually doing something else. So I don't know.
If there are no more questions at this stage, then I think we'll draw the formal parts of the proceedings to a close. But just to encourage you to come and join in the continuing conversation, which will take place in the pub.
The North of Arms.
The North of Arms. Yes, it's not unusual water of Arms, that's why. But there are enough people who know the way who will lead us like sheep. And but do come and join us. It's usually very, very, very pleasant. And again, if you're particularly interested in the topic or you want to have a chance to dine with us, we'd be very, very pleased to have you stay as well. But for now, let's thank Dag very much for his talk.